hello.
I never thought this would happen to me. I'm Tracy. It's nice to meet you.
How you doing, Miss Tracy?
Please have a seat. Get comfy.
Thank you.
No matter where you know our next guest from, you know him from somewhere. Play the dad on Friday. Play the dad on Wayans Brothers. Play the dad on a lot of things.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't meet my dad until late in life, so you were my dad for a while.
Oh, that's wonderful. Was that a good dad?
Please welcome my new dad, John Witherspoon.
Thank you very much. Save it for the singer. Please save it for the singer. Don't applaud me.
So I'm very excited, and I have 1,000 questions.
Yes.
When did you know that you were funny?
I was in a class in Detroit. My brother, I lived with my brother and his wife for 6 months, and I noticed every Thursday they would go to an acting class. And I looked at John Binkelman's acting class. I
said, Binkelman.
I called John Binkelman. Mm-hmm. I didn't know who he was, but he had me doing Shakespeare. I was tearing Othello up. To be or not to be, that is the question.
What that mean?
Whether it's his nobler in the minor, suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortunes, or to take up arms against a sea of trouble, and by opposing in there, to die, perchance to dream, for in the sleep of death, where dreams may come, when we shuffle out this mortal coil, give us pause, and make calamity of solo life, for who can stand the whips and scorns of time? He had me doing that kind of stuff.
Oh, my.
I went back to the ghetto, and everybody told me, spoon! You sound good, boy.
That was amazing.
So you asked me how did I find out I was funny. So Mr. Binkelman had a comedy show every Christmas. He said, think of something. I want you to be on my show this year. I said, I don't know anything about comedy. I'm barely doing this Shakespeare. So he said, I want you to just think of something. And we just put you on the show. You stay up there 3 or 4 minutes. I used to do impressions. So I did an impression of Johnny Mathis.
What if I ask for a little bit of Johnny Mathis?
Right? I can't do it these days. I'm too old for Johnny Mathis. Now, he about 106. But I used to look at me. I'm as helpless as a kitten of a tree. And it seemed like I'm clinging to a cloud I can't understand. I get misty just holding your hand. Oh, that's horrible, Johnny Mathis. I've lost that beautiful voice I used to have.
But I
stole the show. People gave me a standing ovation.
Yeah, and that's when you knew.
I believe I can make some money doing this.
Mm-hmm. So, you're in Detroit,
mm-hmm.
and then you make the long drive to California.
Yeah, but I was doing fine in Detroit. I moved to New York for 3 years.
Strictly to
be a fashion model.
So you went to New York to model.
Yeah, I thought I was a pretty boy. Everybody told me I was pretty until I got to New York. And them dudes look 10 times better than me. And they're all tall. I said, oh, you a fashion model? They said, what do you do? I'm just passing through.
Was it tough making a living? I mean, I'm sure it's tough making a living.
When you first get to LA, oh my God, and New York too was tough.
Like, what is it like?
But it's a gamble that I had to take. You got to take some gamble.
It worked out well for you.
Because I was smart.
Yeah.
I got a job.
Mm-hmm.
I worked at Gucci smelling feet.
I'm sorry.
Selling shoes.
What?
Working at Gucci, selling shoes. And rich folks' feet smell just like poor folks' feet.
That's a word.
I went to the comedy store. Comedy store, see? I worked daytime at Gucci, and then I went down at the comedy store at night. And
performing?
No, I wasn't performing. Mitzi put me on open mic night, which means you come up there, and she's going to see if you're good enough
that
to...
That sounds terrifying.
I had stage presence because I've done stuff before.
Yeah.
But Mitzi had me going to the comedy store. She put me, like I said, open mic night.
Mm-hmm.
So I go and do my old jokes. I'm doing the stuff I saw Red Fox do.
Yeah.
I was so bad. So what I noticed, Mitzi loved people who did voices. She would put on two comics back to back doing the same voice.
What?
And I said, boy, she liked people who does voices.
Hmm.
So I went back and worked on my voices again because I hadn't done it in a while.
So are these voices connected to like a particular character that you
made? You do not. They try to tell us we're too young. Too young to really be in love. So she said, ooh. I saw her do that in the front row. I said, oh, she liked this kind of stuff. And she said, Johnny, you're so good with those voices. I want to put you on. You can work Tuesday and Wednesday in the regular lineup now. And then she made me the MC. I MC'd the second show. David Letterman MC'd the first show.
Wow.
He had a wife, a red truck, and a dog named Bob.
And we're also thankful because I mean, I just assumed that it was this experience in comedy that led you to...
experience that made me do all this.
Yeah.
And she wouldn't give a lot of comics time spots. So I said, let me be the MC. I know I'm going to get on stage because I'm the MC. They can't have the show without me. And she would give me the job as MC.
You take what you learn there.
Yeah.
And you're on the big screen in Friday. And I got
that. Oh, yeah.
And I think, Hollywood Shuffle.
Yeah, but I tell the young guy, you got to go to a room where they're hiring comics. Let me tell you what happened. Sandra Lott was Clint Eastwood's wife. Okay. She was girlfriend then, Sandra Lott.
Okay.
She was directing a movie called Rat Boy. Clint Eastwood come there with Sandra Lott so they can pick people to be in her movie. It's a black movie.
Oh,
it was a black movie, yeah. Rat Boy. Y'all look up. That's a camera. Rat Boy. So now, Clint Eastwood sitting in the back.
Uh-huh.
She going to have the showcase at 8 o'clock. Okay.
Okay.
On a Wednesday night, nobody in the room at 8 o'clock. So I went up on the stage. I'm killing. 8 people dying laughing. So Clint Eastwood told her, come here, come here. Mitzi went over there. And she said, Clint, we about to start the show. He said, I know who I want. I want him. And Mitzi said, no, he's just working. He's the MC. That's all he is. He said, I don't care what he is. I want him to be in the movie. He's the one I want. That's all we need is him.
Wow.
And he got up and left with Sandra Lott before the showcase. And he and his wife were laughing so hard.
Mm.
And I got in that movie, Rat Boy, and I got in the movie Bird. He did Bird. I was in that movie. He called me. He said, I want to.
With Eastwood? Clint Eastwood?
He can ask for me, yeah. He's cool like that.
Huh. Yeah. Imagine being summoned by Clint Eastwood.
Yeah, it's good.
I can't. So here's the question.
Mm-hmm.
I, of course, know you as far as like pop culture and black stuff. For the movie Friday, you've talked about only receiving $5,000.
Ain't that amazing? Ain't that a bitch?
That is about several bitches.
You know how much money they made?
I couldn't.
$300 million. And they paid me $5,000. See, when we first shot the movie, nobody knew the movie was going to be that big.
Yeah, yeah.
It wasn't no big deal in the theaters.
Mm-hmm.
It happened when the kids in the campuses across the country and the colleges spread the word, this is a funny movie.
Mm-hmm.
Go see this movie.
So what did that experience like teach you about the business side and the money side of the business?
Oh, yeah, you're going to get your paper.
Yeah.
Well, I had to pay my rent.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I paid my rent. Second Friday, I made $400,000.
Mm.
And the third Friday, I made over $1 million. But you ain't getting that money. The IRS across the street in a sedan with some binoculars.
Witherspoon. Walk out with your check and they like, thank
Witherspoon.
You.
So the third, fourth Friday, that's why they got to pay more than I paid on the third Friday.
Okay.
You know, I want to get that paper.
Fair.
That would be nice, boy. Be at home, calling my mother. Look here.
I hope to know what that's like one day.
Count that paper.
Like Scrooge McDuck, backstroking in gold.
Thing is, Friday was a very, all that stuff helped me. The first Friday for $5,000. It all helped me. That's how I got a lot of other movies. Because people say, if I saw you on Friday, Charlotte Marlon Wayne said, I have a TV show we're doing. We want you to be our father. So I made good friends with them.
Yeah.
And they put me in. And we did 5 years on Wayne's brother. Tracy Morgan, I was on his show.
Mm-hmm.
I got on his show from all that stuff. You know, people know you in the business. See?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And you do your best.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
At least that's what I do. I do my best. And I add, my thing is I can add lines. Will Smith's show, what was it?
Fresh Prince.
Fresh Prince, I was on there with him. They said, let Witherspoon do anything he want.
What?
And then I was on with Eddie Murphy. I was in Vampire in Brooklyn.
Love Vampire in Brooklyn.
And I ad-libbed so much. What's his name? Wes Craven said, Witherspoon, why don't you read the script? It's funny. I said, I don't need to read the script. I'm good.
I'm funnier.
I know what it's all about.
Mm.
So I got it. You learn a lot from that. You get up here, study your craft, and be diligent. Study your craft.
So thank you so much.
Thanks for having me.
Of course. Thank you for existing and just being yourself.
Thank you very much. I think the key to feeling good is to make a lot of paper.
You know what? This interview's over, Dan.
I ain't finished. Rat Boy. Where was cameraman? Rat Boy. Y'all remember that. R-A-T. Mousy kind of rat. Rat Boy. Rat Boy.